Let's now move on to our third main topic today. Chris, what is our third main topic today?
Third topic is from Samuel Polay. I binged Mindhunter Season 2 this weekend and adored it, but I'm also a little scared. There was a leaked memo from Netflix saying that they don't see a value in keeping shows around longer than two seasons, and I think Mindhunter might be on the chopping block now. Why would Netflix be so draconian with their renewals when that practice could very well scare talented creators, like David Fincher, with ambitious Beyond Season 2s away? What do you guys think about that? Do you think that Netflix is doing that? Do you think that that's a good idea?
Well, I mean, one of the things that I can't speak to, I this memo they mentioned, mm-hmm. I have no idea. I have not heard of any such memo. But there have been reports going around that that is kind of the attitude. Maybe not at two seasons, but two or three seasons has been the attitude going around Netflix about, you know, how long they think their shows could go. As a matter of fact, Business Insider was just writing a report and they said the following: Netflix sees little value in long-lasting shows and prefers ones that run 10 episodes a season and 30 episodes total. After that, they often become too expensive to continue to invest in because the longer shows go, everybody wants raises, they think they earn more money, all that kind of stuff. Become too expensive to continue to invest in unless they are breakout hits that Netflix owns, like Stranger Things. And the shorter the season, the easier it is for new viewers to jump into a show for the first time. So from all these reports that we're getting, Rob, it sounds more and more like this seems to be Netflix's modus operandi. They want to come in, drop a show quick, get it out quick, bring in a new show. And we see this high volume of new content being created by Netflix. Some of it very good, a lot of it really crappy, most of which none of us have ever even hear of because they're the worst company in the world at promoting their own material. But that's a topic for another time. Rob, you've talked for a while about this, you know, habit of Netflix to decide as a business principle, we don't want to pay a lot of money for this content. We spend a lot of money on content. If we go beyond three seasons, it doesn't make much financial sense to us. So first of all, what do you think about that philosophy overall? And as you're seeing more and more reports like this from Business Insider, I know Deadline just did some articles on this recently as well. How does that color the way you're seeing these things right now?
I think it's completely wrongheaded. You know, what they'll do is look, they dropped a Netflix, a preview for the new Dave Chappelle special, which right. kind of came out of nowhere. Like, they'll spend $60 million to have Dave Chappelle do comedy shows. And they're great. I mean, he'll do four specials, now he's doing another one. And people will binge watch them. But when it comes to narrative content like this, they need to be developing a brand loyalty amongst their audience. And in my mind, they have these really great shows like a Mindhunter, which I watched season two this weekend. I loved it. And basically what they're telling me is that when they do have a quality show like this, they don't care about me as a viewer because all they want to do is have, it's like having cans on a shelf. They just want to fill their shelves with cans. But you know what? I might not want to shop in their store anymore if I know that their creative teams that I have a loyalty to, I'm not loyal to Netflix. I'm loyal to the shows that are on Netflix. Mm. And if my creators and the shows I like are not shown the proper respect or they're not given a kind of venue to grow and flourish, then why should I stick around? And I think in the streaming world, you know, Warner Brothers as a studio did a really good job cultivating relationships with filmmakers in the 70s and 80s. I think a lot of these streaming services, and look at Shonda Rhimes right. on network television. Once she gets in, she creates many different shows. And I think that Netflix should start having more loyalty to the creators and the kinds of shows that they're making rather than just putting cans on a shelf. And I think that's what they're counting on. These cans on the shelf are going to bring viewers. I think it's wrongheaded. I think it's short-sighted. And why, as a creator, are you going to want to do your best work for somebody that's going to take your show out after two or three seasons?
Could there be an argument to be made that, you know, because the person writing, I think it was Samuel, wrote in asking, like, you know, aren't you going to alienate your creators like this? Let me ask you this. Is there an argument to be made? Because we all know, like, a guy like Joaquin Phoenix, he was all set and ready to play Doctor Strange. And then ultimately the thing he walked away over was the fact that he did not want to overcommit to playing that character. He didn't want to sign a big multi-film contract. He wanted to be able to go in, do what he loved, and then move on to something else. Could an argument be made that maybe to some creators, the limited scope of a series could actually be, instead of a deterrent, maybe appealing? Is there an argument to be made for that?
I think that's... Yeah. I mean, I think 100%. But here's the thing. If you design a show to run 30 episodes, that's one thing. Mm. But one of these... The thing about these Netflix shows is they order a show, it becomes a breakout hit. Like, you know, Mindhunter, it becomes a water cooler show. You talk about it. I certainly want to see where the Department of Behavioral Sciences is going. And they're building a story over the last two seasons for a serial killer that they haven't even dealt with yet. And it's like, well, I want to see these characters go on. I love this show. The acting in this show is unbelievable. I mean, it's unbelievable. And I want more of it. And maybe that's just me being selfish. But, I mean, where is Netflix? They're giving us shows. And if the shows that we love, if they're just going to take them away, then why invest? Unless you know that it's designed to be three seasons from the get-go. But even they don't know. Like they said, unless they own it or it's a breakout hit, they're not going to continue. But they don't know that. Like Sex Education, which was a show with Gillian Anderson, and I love this British show. It's great. Who knows if it'll ever come back? I don't know. But I loved it, and I would like to watch these characters move on. And I think it's a bad strategy.
Well, here's the other thing. To your point, I think what Netflix is failing to grasp here is that your long-term successful shows become the backbone of your thing. Let's look at for a second at HBO, right? HBO, look, they always create really good content. But over the past 8 years, there have been windows of time when maybe they haven't had the strongest lineup, and then they do and whatever. But Game of Thrones was running. And no matter what was going on with the rest of the network, Game of Thrones was there. People were going to be subscribed to HBO to watch Game of Thrones, so that when they brought along their, what's the one about the actor turned assassin?
Barry.
So when you bring along a Barry, or you bring along a Euphoria, which I tried to watch and I didn't like all that much, to be honest. Anyway, when you bring along a Euphoria, you've got your audience there. I think it's not an either or. I don't think Netflix has to approach this by looking at, well, if we're going to do a show, we got to be committed to making 5, 6, 7, 8 seasons. No, but why go in there with a predetermined kill date for it? Like, why not have 2 or 3 shows that are going to last 6, 7, 8, 9 seasons? That, like you were pointing out so rightly, Rob, develop some brand loyalty so that people are stick around there, and those people are more likely to discover new content you bring along. I understand the idea of you want to keep costs in check. I get that. And I agree. But there's got to be a happy medium where there's a way to do that without, you know, employing an overall philosophy of let's just kill everything after 3 seasons.
Yeah. You know? Well, also, you know, if you're going to create a zeitgeist show, a water cooler show, and you want people to talk, like Mindhunter, I spent a day and a half and it's done. You know, I might not go back to Netflix for another 2, 3 weeks, month or two. Who knows? I mean, Mindhunter was something that I was really looking forward to. And when HBO had Game of Thrones going and it was running 10 episodes a season, you've got 10 weeks where people are talking about HBO, you know? Yes. Now, in my mind, Netflix has become like a one-show binge thing. Like, oh, I wanted to watch Mindhunter. I loved it last season. I was waiting for it to come back. When it came back, then it's over and gone because all the episodes are available. Now, I kind of, in a way, would like to have strung it out a little bit. I think it's really interesting that shows, like, whether they're on Hulu. I watched The Path. Not a lot of people watch The Path, but it was on Hulu. I'd wait for it to come back, and it was a weekly show. And I would go back to Hulu every week to watch The Path and see what's new, what's here. With Netflix, I feel like it's in one ear and out the other. For all of those shows, I turn it on, it feels like there's a bunch of white noise, and then there's the one show that I want to watch. And then if I find out that, oh, A Dark is good or something, I'll go binge watch that, and then it's done. But I have no... I look around Netflix, and it becomes more annoying because I don't know anything about half the stuff that's on the channel. And it becomes something... I don't like that experience. Netflix needs to do something to make the experience of going on to Netflix beyond what I want to see more enjoyable, or they're not going to survive.
Oh, see, I have the totally different experience with Netflix each time. I'm like, really? Oh, I just binge the show. I know Netflix is so good for stand-up comedy. They're cornering that market. Okay, I'm going to watch some stand-up comedy.
They
now.
Are doing really Ooh. Well in that area.
Yeah, now I'm going to check out this new anime that just dropped. Oh my gosh, Cannon Busters is out. I'm going to watch all of this now. And I can jump around to different things. And I do want to circle back to what you guys were saying about creators. I do think the Netflix model does appeal to kind of that British BBC kind of mentality. You know, the Ricky Gervaises of the world. The people who do have that thing they're ending in mind when it comes to their show. Three seasons and done. We talked about Shonda Rhimes earlier. We talked about Arrow earlier. I mean, Grey's Anatomy, that had a musical episode. A medical drama had a musical episode. That jumped the shark. Arrow had dips so bad later on. Sometimes a show shouldn't last longer than three or four seasons. So I'm hoping that that is more of a note about quality for Netflix than it is a quantity thing. Obviously, they are trying to churn out as many shows as possible, but I don't know. It makes me feel a little more optimistic about the content they want to create.
I got to speak to something you were saying, though, to what Rob was saying, though, too. I find my experience, although I've never articulated it the way you just did, which is somebody was asking me the other day, what streaming service do I watch more than anything else? Netflix, right? And I'm like, actually, no, probably Hulu more than anything else. Like, I probably watch Hulu maybe five times more than I watch Netflix because, and I've never framed it like this until you pointed it out, Rob, is that I hit Netflix, it's hit and run. It's a one-night stand with Netflix. It's like, oh, okay, what's the most, I guess Stranger Things was the last thing. I was like, Stranger Things is there. Great, go to Netflix, binge it. I was done in a day. And I don't know that I've gone back to Netflix since I've watched Stranger Things. Other than maybe watch a comedy special here or there, whereas like you were pointing out, we've talked a lot on the show recently about the week by week release schedule versus the thing, it would have drawn it out anyway.
I think Chris's point, you know, that she articulated was also a very important one. But you're predisposed to liking comedy and liking anime.
Yeah.
So you're an audience member that has a broad interest in topics, which I think they're kind of counting on.
Yeah.
And I think because look, I've gotten sucked into small house things or people renovating their gardens. I mean, there's so many things that Netflix has sucked me into that I've randomly stumbled across. Mm-hmm. But it is sort of it, like you said, I like the idea that Netflix is kind of like your F buddy. You know, you go, it's a booty call. Like, I'm going to get my entertainment booty call from Netflix. I'm going to get in. I'm going to be delighted for an evening. And then I'm going to get out. I might not call for another couple weeks, you know, until the inkling hits me again to pick up that phone and see what's on Netflix. What's up, baby? How you doing?
Why do I hear a hotline ring in the back of my head, the song playing in my head? Anyway, guys, listen. What do you guys think about all this? Do you think this is a good long-term strategy for Netflix? Do you have concerns about it like some of us do? What do you think about their whole approach to this? Jump down to the comment section below and let us know your thoughts. All right.